Hi, I'm Greg Mickling. New Jersey credit unions believe that all citizens need to understand the important financial matters that affect their lives. That's why we're proud to support the programming produced by the Caucus Educational Corporation and their partners in public television.
This special edition of One on One with Steve Adubato is brought to you from the Tisch WNET studios at Lincoln Center. Funding has been provided by Barnabas Health, St. Peter's University, the Jesuit University of New Jersey, United Water, making the planet sustainable is the best job on Earth. QualCare Inc., a local managed care company covering 750,000 New Jersey residents. New Jersey's credit unions, banking you can trust. Johnson & Johnson, and by the law firm of Gibbons PC. Promotional support provided by the Star Ledger, powering NJ.com, and by the New Jersey Business and Industry Association and its monthly magazine, New Jersey Business.
This is One on One.
When you first heard that they were doing Charlie Rose and Gayle King, didn't you go, what?
People like laughing at others, so I don't mind if the other is me.
See, you go right into the character. That's what it is.
I'm bringing families together a half an hour each week. Man, I'm doing something special.
And so I do feel successful.
Hi, I'm Steve Adubato. Welcome to the Tisch WNET studio here in the heart of Lincoln Center, New York City. It is my honor, my pleasure. Back by popular demand, we have Mia Toschi. And she is a contributing author and photographer on a wonderful book called Surviving Sandy. The Superstorm That Reshaped Our Lives is a big, powerful, and important book, right? What is the book about, and why'd you write it?
Well, the reason why we put this together was to not only, this was a historic storm, first of all, we're focused probably more on the New York, New Jersey area, but if you look at Haiti, that lost 30% of its crops, this storm traveled from Haiti all the way up here and did so much devastation. So it was historic in nature. Number two, well, we wanted to highlight some of the wonderful heroes, whether it was the police chief down in Seaside Heights who saved 36 people, or the staff from Jenkinson's Aquarium who stayed the night to save all the animals there. I mean, there were true stories of heroism, but what we really wanted to do was help pay it forward. This book, 100% of the proceeds are being donated to charities that are dedicated to the ongoing relief efforts. And so far, we're very happy to say that we have given away five $1,000 checks, and we're going to be focusing on some of the individuals who are in need in the next coming weeks.
It's so interesting. We're doing this show as we move into spring of 2014. The show will be seen after as well in repeats. For so many, Hurricane Sandy is so far behind them in their minds, but for so many who are not in their homes, not back in their businesses, they can continue to suffer and struggle. When you talk to those folks, do they think we've forgotten them?
Absolutely. I always use the reference that you go west of Pennsylvania and Sandy is a long-forgotten memory. If you go down to the Jersey Shore, you go over to Long Beach, New York, or Breezy Point, or any of these places in this area, not too far from these studios. I mean, you can travel, you're there
Describe
in an hour.
Breezy Point. I'm sorry for interrupting. Describe Breezy Point, because everyone heard Breezy Point, but they had no idea how devastating it was.
I'll tell you, a lot of folks that I've spoken to outside the area, and I'm prefacing it with one little point, often say, well, it's New York. They have money. They can rebuild. But Breezy Point was an area that was, if you look at the people there, they're hardworking. Absolutely.
Firemen,
a lot of police officers.
Cops.
Yep, exactly. And so many of these people couldn't get back into their homes. And I would probably say, and it's very hard to give the estimate, there's tens of thousands of people still out of their homes, but these were permanent homes. These weren't vacation homes. So, I mean, it's just so devastating.
Do this for me. As a photojournalist, we're going to run some pictures, put them up there. I'm going to ask you to describe what you see. Let's shoot them, folks. Put them up. What are we looking at?
This is an area in Long Beach, New York. You can see that the cars are underwater. This was about three blocks away from the ocean, so you can see how far that water traveled. That's about 2-3 feet, and that probably was actually at the lower point.
Keep going, team.
This was one of the boardwalks. This was over in a portion of Seaside Heights, and this, you can just see how strong that storm surge was just to break the boards in half. And those boards, by the way, had been there for years.
And by the way, add on top of that, we were just down there. over the summer, the fire on top of the boardwalk that makes it even worse. What
absolutely.
Are we seeing now?
This is Staten Island. This is one of the photos. You couldn't believe Staten Island. They really actually probably had the most damage and the most loss of life. But this was just one picture. You can see the vacation fund, just so many personal items. And when you would walk through and people were just picking up, I mean, as a TV reporter, I've covered fires. And you sometimes go and, you know, your heart breaks because these people have lost everything. You were walking up and down the blocks seeing thousands of people who lost everything. And so it is far, far from over. I know that we've heard from some elected officials that have said, you know, we're back in business. I totally understand that. You need to say that to get the dollars back down there. Absolutely, completely, 100% agree. And I would encourage everybody to spend the time in any of these areas. However, it is still an enormous work in process.
Let's take a look at some of the firefighters, because they're such an important part of this. What are we seeing?
This was another area. This was just outside of Breezy Point as firefighters were trying to get their way through there. Many of them had to wade through waters. And when they came back home, a lot of them, because they worked and they lived in these working class neighborhoods, they came home and didn't have a home. So it was a double whammy for them.
Tell me about one of the firefighters. It's fascinating. Is it Kinga Milnick?
Kinga Milnick, yeah. It's probably my favorite story because it was a happy story to some extent.
One of the few.
She's a FDNY firefighter for 8 years with the FDNY. Fabulous lady. Gave birth to her third son.
Is that her?
That's her, with Adrian Storm. The little boy, and she named her son, her third son, Adrian Storm.
Adrian Storm.
And so he'll obviously be two on October 29th.
When was he born?
October 29th, the night of the storm.
Wow.
Yeah, absolutely. She's an incredible lady. Her house was completely gone.
Completely gone.
It has since been rebuilt, and she got back in about 14 months later.
And this baby.
He's absolutely adorable. Absolutely adorable.
It's so interesting. You know, for so many, as I said before, people want to move on. And for so many of these folks, they can't. And we'll talk about it being a home or being a business as if it's just infrastructure or brick and mortar or pictures. You can replace pictures. It's not that. It's the emotional, psychological, the deep wounds, the scars. And I don't think we can appreciate or understand it. It's so interesting because for some of us, we're like, oh, yeah, we're going to have our second home down the shore. We're going to build a home. We got to rent down the shore. That's not what we're talking about here.
Mm-hmm.
That is not what we're talking about. We are talking about people for whom right now we're going on 18 months.
18, yeah.
18 months. They have no sense of when they're going to be back in their homes, which means they are not living their lives.
And that anxiety that they have just continues to grow because, like you said, they don't have answers. I wrote the tribute in the book, and I interviewed a lady by the name of Colleen Varell, who was from Lavalette, New Jersey. And
what's
she
her name
said,
again?
Colleen Varell.
From our hometown down the shore,
there
is Lavalette. Great town.
Yep, it's a great town.
And the town next to it, Orly Beach, has been devastated.
Yeah, I have probably 10 friends that lost homes there.
Oh, go ahead, I'm sorry.
No. But she said it, and she goes, you know, we celebrated 46 anniversaries there, you know, 28 birthdays, communions, and you know, she just kept going on, and it's where you welcomed the warm, hot air and
yeah.
said goodbye to every summer, but yet it was always a part of your life, and that's a big part of everybody's life. So we do say that for every, you know, one of the reasons why we did do the book is so that we can help some of these not only the foundations, but the individuals.
What impact has the book had on you as a person?
As a reporter, it's really funny.
Can you distance yourself?
I have distanced myself. I've covered 9/11. I've covered the tsunami in Southeast Asia. I've covered AIDS in South Africa. I've been all over the world. I've seen some pretty awful stuff. I mean, obviously, I'm a native New Yorker also. Grew up in West 23rd Street. When you saw 9/11, I guess in a certain way, you know, you were counting your friends and those who lost people. This time it was the people that lost houses, so it wasn't quite as devastating. But I think you always come back and you say, what got me through? And I think it's always the when people come together, and you know, we always have that expression with the foundation that I also work with, 9/12 Generation Foundation, that what we do is about 9/12, and I think this really translates to Sandy.
Day.
Yeah, when you
what
looked
do we do
at,
after?
Look at all the volunteers that came from all over the world to help us here. We're far from over from rebuilding, but I met guys. I met a group of students from Saudi Arabia.
Who are those people?
This is a group.
And then you go back to Saudi Arabia. Who are they?
This is Hutch Ryder. He was one of the gentlemen right in the front in the left. He was he lost his house in Staten Island. He's a firefighter, and this was a group. In fact, I think the boy up there in the second row, he was one of the kids from Saudi Arabia. We've got a couple of Merrill Lynch folks and a couple of folks from New York says thank you also.
Yeah, what do you do the day after? You try to rebuild, right? So the Saudi Arabia folks, you were saying?
Just amazing just to see people that came from Saudi Arabia or school groups from Virginia. I mean, they came from all over the country. Yeah. And that was really, I mean, that's inspiring.
Real quick before I let you go, who else was involved in this project?
The students from Pascack Valley Learning Center.
Yeah.
It really was kind of their
great
idea.
Story.
And they are from the tri-state area, so they come from Connecticut, New York, and New Jersey, and they basically said, we want to do something. One of their parents was able to obtain some funding, which was pretty miraculous, and ambient funding, I guess you would say, came to the rescue. And because of my work with children and as a journalist, they sort of contacted me, and I was very, very happy to do so, and it's been a wonderful journey.
And the proceeds are going, in fact, to people who need help, organizations
absolutely.
That are out there. Mia, I want to thank you for joining us once again here on One-on-One from Lincoln Center. Come back anytime. Surviving Sandy, the superstorm that reshaped our lives. Thank you. Keep doing important work.
Great to see you. Thank you.
Stay with us. We'll be right back right after this from Lincoln Center.
If you would like more information on this program or if you'd like to express an opinion, email us at info@caucusnj.org. Visit us online at oneonone.org. Find us on Facebook at facebook.com/Steve Adubato, PhD, and follow us on Twitter at Steve Adubato.
There she is. She's Drita from Mob Wives, the hit show on VH1. Everybody wanted her, at least in my family. My wife Jennifer and I said, we want Drita, and now we got her. How you
Thank
doing?
Thank you. Good. Tell your wife I said hi.
Yeah, well, she's here in the studio right now watching you. No, I'll admit it. She's here.
That's awesome.
She came to Lincoln Center because she wanted to see you with her crazy friend Christy because they love the show. Did you ever think it would be, I didn't mean officially crazy, Christy, but how popular... Did you ever think it would be this popular?
I did. I'm not going to say no, only because I felt like it was never done before. And I think when something has never been done, it's so much more interesting. This was like taken out of, you know, reality world into a world everyone's familiar with all over the world. So I think because people are so intrigued with mob movies and this lifestyle, that's all they, you know, The Godfather till this day is one of the best movies. I just feel like going in the real homes and the kitchen to see the wife and children on how they truly live was going to be a big deal.
You know, it's interesting because we are not here to glorify nor...
No, and I don't think the show glorifies
Because you
it.
Have these two wonderful daughters.
Yes.
And your husband spent some time...
Yes, a lot.
...away from the family.
Yes.
And there are others. Every one of the women in the show has some connection to someone in their family who has done time. Let's just say that. And the show is about not really those men so much.
No.
But about the women in their lives and the children in their lives and the impact on family, no?
Yeah, I mean, it's, I think everyone that was asking, how can you do the show, blah, 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 they always said, how does it make sense? Well, for one, it is because we're talking about ourselves. I do see a lot of young kids that, you know, they think it's cool, that lifestyle, and they want to be like, you know, they just want to be someone that they shouldn't want to be. And I feel like when the show airs, I would like the younger generation to look at it and be like, wow, like we don't see this because movies do glorify this lifestyle. And this show is showing half the women distraught, crying, you know, really bad things. Like every time I talk about my kids, I'd cry. My kids went through a lot. It's not something to talk about. It's just, it's not a good thing. And when you're young and you don't know any better and you go into, you know, everyone has been young and they're in love and they don't get it. If I knew what I knew now, you know, to hurt my kids the way, because of my husband's choices, you know, it changed him as a person, thank God. But hopefully it'll change millions of people, because I know people in prison watch the show. I know this for a fact.
You do know.
And when they watch the show, it has affected them to see my daughter cry about the father. I don't think they really realize what they've done to their families until they watched it.
Your daughters are how old?
13 and 6.
Your youngest daughter, there was a period of time, I'm trying to remember this, did she didn't see her dad for a really long time.
And she didn't even know who he was. It was awful. And you know what? I used to tell, like, the producers, can you not bring up my daughters, because it makes me cry. And they would be like, Drita, you know, that's why we love this show, because of the realness in it. It's just so real. And my oldest daughter actually went through the worst, the hardest time, because she had her father, and then he was gone. She had her dad, and then he was gone. She just...
Because he went away twice.
Right. And she was so in love with him, and then she didn't understand, like, where is he again? Mm-hmm. You know, there's just so many women that are divorced, and there's so many women that have husbands. Doesn't mean prison, that are away. Maybe they're, you know, in war or whatever it is. They're hurting, and they're missing a loved one, and yeah. Their children are missing a loved one. So too many people can relate.
You know, it's so funny. It is a reality show, and the show is created by Renee's sister, Jennifer.
Yes.
One of the characters, not characters, she's a person, as Renee. She's the shy one. I'm joking.
That's
I'm
so
joking.
Funny because you just shocked me. I got you.
I got you. And you know, Method Man's coming in. I'm joking again, because we watch the show.
Yeah.
We know these things.
Renee's so, really shy.
Renee is intense. Let's just say she's got some anger issues. And her sister, I think Jennifer.
She works on the show as the executive producer, but think about how difficult that is for us.
I can't even comprehend it. So
there's
Big Ange, who's got a bar out on the island, Staten Island. Not Long Island, trust me, folks, it's Staten Island. And that bar is called... Christy,
Drunken
you've been
Monkey.
There. What's it called?
Drunken
the Drunken Monkey. And also, who else? There's two young ladies from Philly.
Yes, actually, Natalie is from Philly, and Alicia Storrs in Philly. Alicia's really from Cherry Hill, New Jersey, but she's always in Philly. But they're both from Philly. It's like Philly meets New York.
Yeah, that's interesting. So we actually have a clip of you and Alicia. Now, Alicia's husband has got some issues with the feds, big issues.
Big.
And again, because there are timing issues here with the show, I believe that as we've watched the show, Alicia was waiting to get sentenced because she got pulled into this case involving her husband and the feds because she was involved in this business. And I believe there's a scene of you walking with Alicia from Philly, suburban New Jersey, Cherry Hill, and you're walking on the boardwalk talking about life.
Yeah, and you know what? It's a very real
moment.
Let's
take a look at the clip.
My father is, like, so legitimate. Like, he wouldn't steal a pack of gum. It's so weird how I ended up with someone so opposite of my father.
Welcome to my world.
I heard Alicia's here in New York, so I invited her to the boardwalk in Staten Island on my side of town. I don't know Alicia very long, but we have so much in common. I'm impressed by how strong Alicia is, because it's not only her dealing with Eddie in jail, she's dealing with facing jail time herself. And then that takes balls right there. I can relate so much to what Alicia's going through, especially with her husband. He was leading a double life, and the shock is not easy to deal with.
I just think it's unfair, period, what's happening to her.
She's not a gangster, she ain't part of no nothing. She's a wife with kids, that's it.
Wow.
I can't believe that she's still facing jail.
She has not been sentenced, yes,
no.
as we do this program.
Right.
She has two boys?
Three boys.
Oh.
I know. You know, when I watch the show and she does scenes, because what people don't realize is we do watch the show with everyone else. So that's the first time I've seen it.
Well, back up, Drita. You watch the show with everyone else.
Meaning
We're watching it.
We watch it together.
Wait a minute. You don't get to see it
right.
months
and no
before?
One knows that. Like, people don't realize that I never saw. No, actually, this is even crazier. I know our show probably is the only one that does this. It's so true to time, meaning other shows, they film, then they air, they're hanging out, they've seen it. It's so not the case with Mob Wives. What happens is we film, and they start airing it during filming. So now, let's say I just film with you. You're so sweet. And then I sit and watch you talking about me, and I got to go film with you next week.
Oh.
Right. So in a way, it's kind of brilliant. But on the flip side,
because it gets, excuse me for interrupting. It's brilliant because it gets a visceral, intense reaction from you.
By the way, the other thing
I noticed about you, maybe in another part of your life, you get physical. You like to fight. Now, I was born and raised in Newark, New Jersey, and we used to fight too, but I am deathly afraid of you because you could kick my ass.
I changed my ways.
Did I say that? You could kick. I think you could. I'm pretty confident you could take me.
You're tough, and you
have gotten into physical confrontations.
Yeah.
And have you made a commitment that you're not going to do that anymore?
Yeah. And I went to see, like, anger management and everything.
How's that working for you?
Works great. In a split second, I'm like, boom, my head pops off. But I'm just like, I think it did work a little bit because I started to not, now I verbally argue and I don't swing. It's a big difference. I used to just swing. I figured, you know what, we're fighting. We fight all the way or don't fight at all. I don't want to argue with, you know, you fight with me.
But you also realized, it's so interesting because for the show, for that kind of public television, you know that we are into discussion, civil discourse.
My God, no kidding. That's why my brother was like, you can't do this show. When I said I'm going to do a reality show, he's like, you can't do a reality. He's like, reality shows, the women argue all the time. He's like, hello, you know,
I thought your brother said you couldn't do PBS.
He's like,
we're the Big Bird station. Okay.
But hold on. Big Bird.
Yeah, we all love Big Bird.
Really?
But here's what's interesting about it is that in some ways, those physical confrontations are great for that kind of television. But I bet on some level, because you have
for
been.
For me, it's not.
But
it's
that's
awful.
What's interesting, because you've often
awful.
Said you've regretted it. You've cried over it. You're 100%. Embarrassed over it. You wish it never happened. I'm thinking to myself, why did Drita get herself into that? Because she feels terrible over it.
You really believe that, I know I did. I really truly believe that because I'm like, I said to my brother, you think I'm gonna fight on national TV with cameras around? I truly, first of all, I said I wasn't gonna even curse ever on the show. I was like, I'm a mom now. Won't use profanity. I'm not gonna swing on anyone, blah, blah, blah. The problem with me is I can't be me for 1 second.
You what?
I can't be me, meaning I can't be fake. Not even for a second. When I start filming, I'm like, I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna, you know, I wanna portray myself to be, so my kids see me in a different light.
Right.
That's all I had in mind was my kids. So when I watched a show and I got physical, I was very emotional because I'm gonna have to answer to my daughters one day. And that's not, I'm actually a very strict mom.
By the way, you are a strict mom. Your daughters are not just sweet, but they seem so well-behaved.
Thank you.
They do their homework.
Yes.
And we try to get our children to watch your children so that our children do their homework. I'm not lying, by the way. I'm not joking at all.
That's awesome.
But the other thing is, you come from very strict Albanian. People are like, oh, Drita's Italian.
I know.
I'm like, no, she's not.
No.
Albanian. Your father was very strict. You played soccer as a little girl, and they were not overwhelmed that you were marrying into an Italian, let's just say, a different culture that they were not enamored with.
It actually was not that. My father actually speaks beautiful, fluent Italian, has lived in Italy for a very long time. My mom, too. They speak beautiful Italian.
Was it the lifestyle?
It was the lifestyle. My father
nothing
is
nothing to do with Italian, I'm sorry. So it's
no,
nothing
it has
to do with Italian,
it has
it's the
nothing,
lifestyle.
Yeah, and a lot of people thought that because there is certain nationalities that are that way. But my father, you know, like I said, he lived in Italy. He speaks beautiful Italian. It was the lifestyle. And he, you know, my brother went to college. My father was a college coach. He was like, what
soccer.
Are you doing? Yes, what are you doing? What choice are you making
What'd
here?
What did you say to him? Love?
You know what? Yeah, you think you know everything when you're young. And that's what a moron you are when you're young, really, when you think about it.
But you're staying in.
Well, because you know what I also see was raised in a family that you stick it out. I don't have divorces in my family. They don't just get divorced. They work it out. And everybody does do that. And I was brought up that way. You get married, you're loyal, you're faithful to that man, and you stick it out. I mean, me and Lee had our issues when we weren't together, but we got back.
The other thing about you that's fascinating is while Lee was away, you started building this business.
Yeah.
A couple businesses, right? Talk about your business.
Oh, I went on a mission.
Describe.
I think it's because when he went away, I lost everything. I had everything, and in one morning, I lost everything. I had a business. I had a beautiful home. I had everything. And that one day, I had to hand over the key to someone that bought my house. I was sitting on that staircase pregnant and thinking, Well, I have nothing. Like, when I leave here, I go back in my old room. He's in jail for the next 6.5, 7 years, and I have nothing or no one to help me financially. From that day, I went to school. I did everything I had to do. I was doing makeup. Once this show start, I said, I'm going to do this show, but I'm going to make sure I build something positive because I don't know what's going to happen with Lee. I don't trust that. I don't trust anybody, unfortunately, because I've heard it all, that I will never go back to jail and this and that. So for me, I said, I'm going to do what I have to do to have my daughters
what's
look up to me.
What's the name of your business?
Lady Boss.
Where's it based?
In Staten Island. I actually have 2 retail stores in Staten Island, and I sell in over 10 countries.
What's it like being a business person?
Amazing. And I love it because my daughters always go, I can't believe you did all this, Mom. You have clothes, you have makeup, skincare, I have everything.
Proud of yourself?
Yes.
Your daughters are proud of you?
That's why I'm proud of myself, because my daughters are proud of me. And when
so
they
you get emotional
like
when
that,
you talk about your kids?
Always.
And your business.
Yeah, why are you doing this to me? I feel like I'm a mob wife.
It's not just business, is it?
No, it's everything, because it means a lot to me that my daughters are proud of me.
Yeah. Listen, I want to thank you for coming in.
No, I want to thank you for having me.
We appreciate it. You know, it's funny. We can appreciate the show because it's entertaining. And I know some people are turned off because Italians are looked at in a certain way, but as an Italian-American, I have my own views of that, because the other side is it's real life, and I see your children, your daughters, and I see the way you are as a mom, and I say this to my wife, Jennifer, all the time. Most of all, as a parent, I'm just proud of the way you are as a parent, and your husband's doing the best he can. And most of all, we wish your daughters nothing but the best.
Because, thank you.
They're going to be okay because of the way you are.
Oh, thank you. Oh, my God, you're going to make me cry.
What am I, Oprah? Listen, all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you.
One-on-One with Steve Adubato has been a production of the Caucus Educational Corporation, celebrating 25 years of broadcast excellence. In partnership with St. Joseph's Healthcare System. This special edition of One-on-One with Steve Adubato is brought to you from the Tisch WNET Studios at Lincoln Center. Funding has been provided by Barnabas Health, St. Peter's University, United Water, QualCare Inc., New Jersey's Credit Unions, Johnson & Johnson, and by the law firm of Gibbons PC. Transportation provided by Airbrook Limousine, serving the metropolitan New York, New Jersey area.
Each year, Americans fill 4 billion prescriptions, but as much as 1/3 of that medication will never be used. Some of this waste ends up in the rivers, lakes, and streams that make up our drinking water supply. The United Water Foundation and the National Community Pharmacists Association have partnered to bring you a simple solution. Dispose your meds responsibly. Go to disposemymeds.org to find a participating pharmacy and to learn more. A public service message from the United Water Foundation and NCPA.